So using this scale, you can, for example, look at the excess within the around 26 couples in the main hamlet, and within these couples, we can see what is the excess of women and excess of men. And looking at it like this, we can see that the overall average wasn't the same for men and women just because the people in the couple would share the same access to the same people or the same resources. You can see that there are some couples where women have much higher access than men and vice versa. So how is this related to education? Very strongly. The people who have the highest education have access to the highest number of items in the battery, and those who have no education have very limited access to the resources, indicating the access to external society. This is what it looks like when you split the sample by occupation. So among the farmers, those who are socioeconomically better off have higher access to resources of the external society than those who are landless and can be considered poor. The non-farmers in the sample, although very few, they all have very high access outside. If you look at it within the categories, so for example, among the landowners, those with better education have higher access. Or among those with the same education, those who have more land or better socioeconomic status have higher access. So both of these dimensions are important. Now, let's move on to, so what is the impact of the phones on this? First question is, who got a mobile phone? You can see that it's very strongly related to the socioeconomic status of the respondent. The poor ones, the landless ones, only around one quarter in the sample has a mobile phone, but among the adults, the mobile phone is quite frequent. By the way, if one person in a married couple has a mobile phone, it's considered that both people in the couple own the mobile phone. Also, mobile phone ownership is very strongly related to education. Although literacy is not a necessary condition to use a mobile phone, most people, even those who are educated in this Indian community, never use texting, they just use usually the phone for calling their friends or family. And again, both of these are important. So this is quite an important question. Would you buy a mobile phone if it cost only 500 rupees? In the time of the survey, the cheapest mobile phones were around 1500 rupees, or minimum, really, second-hand 1000 rupees. And among those 43 surveyed people who don't have a mobile phone, 38 said, yes, I would like to. So it proves that the affordability of the mobile phone is the main variable in ownership, explaining the ownership. And you can also see that the mobile phone owners have a much higher access, especially to the rare resources. The red lines are non-owner's access divided by the owner's access. Blue line is access of everyone. So mobile phone owners do have higher access to resources, especially to the rare ones, but it is not because of the mobile phones. It's the other way around. Those who have better position, who are simply richer, who have better education, have better access to resources, and these people get the mobile phone. It will be explained actually, or confirmed by one more question in the next slide. And this slide is about the mobile phone for access. So these people who own the mobile phones, they use it to access the resources outside. They call, for example, in case of the lawyer, this item is accessed almost entirely by mobile phone. But these contacts were not created by mobile phones. this is, I think, a very interesting question. Have you ever called anyone whom you hadn't known about before? And out of 36 mobile phone owners, only 6 have ever called anyone who wasn't their close friend or family member, or whom they didn't know about before, the phone call. And so this, at the first look, if you think about it like from the viewpoint of international development literature and everything, can be surprising, but why do the mobile phones don't help more like the people to instrumentally increase their likes? But if you think about it, well, it's actually kind of obvious, like in the world where there are no phone directories or anything, you just cannot call anyone who you don't know well, and you cannot call anyone outside the hills if you just simply don't know anyone there. So using the same illustration as in the beginning, it would look more like this. The people who had access to the external society, they use the advantage of phones to have the access now speedier and more comfortable and cheaper. But the other farmers, they didn't really try, even if they bought a mobile phone, they didn't really try to access the markets directly. And one of the reasons they said it's just like too expensive to try to bring my own goods to the market myself. It's just the economic scale, like when the one person that has the contacts, the broker, just buys the stuff from everyone and brings it somewhere, it's much easier. So in the context where the infrastructure connecting the two worlds is not sufficient, adding just the mobile phones doesn't make so much difference for most of the people. But it is true that the people, everyone, uses the mobile phones really for their pleasure or to contact their family members. Most of the people have used the mobile phone to call a distant a family member in case of some funeral or something. So to maintain the family ties or just for like chat with friends, it's a very useful tool indeed. So this is the summary of the relations which I showed before. So the ascribed status, the farmer's position, which is given by the amount of the land they inherited, is important in many senses. First of all, those who don't have any land, the landless farmers, their children have to work on someone else's land, so they can go to school. So there is a strong link between the inherited status and the attained status in terms of education. Moreover, those who have the highest socioeconomic resources related to the amount of land possessed and related to the education can afford a phone. And the people with the highest education, again, and the highest property have the best access to external resources to the society thanks to their structural advantage. And they use their phones to better mobilize these resources embedded in the social structure, but then they don't use the phones yet to access new resources. So about the resources, the empirical pattern was developed by inductive analysis. So it wasn't like that from theory we would come up with resources that represent the access to external society, but we just had like large number of resources and those that were related together in the data but given by the respondents' answers are those that represent access to the external society. So this is probably an important trait for the respondents. About the phones, again, those who could afford it purchased a phone, but in future when the price of the phones goes down and with the planned governmental subsidies, this digital divide probably will disappear because everyone one day will be able to afford it if they want to. The way of using the phone is quite funny or interesting. People within the hamlet, they sometimes try to call each other, but when the signal doesn't work, they just shout, which is the traditional way, and it always works. So they first make a call, if the person is not coming out, they just shout out the name, they shout back, and that's how it works. within the hills, people mainly walk because there is not coverage in other villages outside in the hills. And when people want to access the city, they use the phone, they use the phone if they know someone in the city. So, but new resources were not accessed, mainly because the geographical remoteness and the lack of the other types of infrastructure. So, a note on the space relationship to social networks would be that distance really matters. It's not that the world is flat, as some people are saying, but the distance is not just simple geographical distance or Euclidean distance. It's distance in terms of time and affordability to interact with the other person. And it's not just continuous. You know, for example, in the case of the mountains, there's huge difference between accessing the people who are just at the edge of the hill and the people who are below. So it's not just about the straight distance. And the distance also depends on the infrastructure, whether it's available or not. For example, if there's regular, very cheap bus going to the city, it's much easier to develop, obviously, contacts outside, or when it's subsidized. So this is the first part of the talk. This is the relationship of the mobile phones to the social networks that access resources. If you have any question, I'll just continue with the second part. And that's why it is important to have access to various resources. So this case is in Manila, and that's why the slums are not in Tokyo, unfortunately. And we looked at a slum, actually 12 slum communities in the south of Metro Manila, the capital of the Philippines, and chose one of the communities for an in-depth study. Here, we used a different technique for measuring the access to resources. The problem with measuring the access to resources directly is that it's quite actually difficult and time-consuming to develop the meaningful battery of resources for every different society. Maybe if you just want to study the, say, Western world with kind of similar values and everything, then maybe like one battery of kind of universally valued resources would work. But if you want to study like very different communities, then you would have to adjust the battery every time, which is not very good, or which is quite time-consuming. So here we used a method developed by Lin and Damil, and they based their method on a theory that the amount of resources you own is mainly represented by your occupational prestige. Your occupational, if you imagine that there is some sort of hierarchical organization of the society, this sort of pyramid shape, the occupational prestige is like the best single estimate of where you are in the structure. And where you are in the structure relates to what kind of resources you have control of. But it's not necessarily always that higher is better. Like different type of resources are better for different type of things. So for example, lawyers and doctors have the generally highest prestige among most of the societies in the world. But knowing just doctors and lawyers, it doesn't mean that you have a good social network for all purposes. Like when you want to have someone to help you with washing dishes or something, it's not so useful to know too many lawyers. On the other hand, knowing the diversity of access is what is usually good for you. And the good thing about this is that this broad classification of occupational categories of the labor organization is really similar in, or should be similar, they say, among all societies in the world, including like some tribal communities. You always have someone who has the role of being a policeman or the role of being like a leader or someone who is like a doctor and so on. So we use this method. We developed, this was easier, a number of occupations based on the Philippine labor and labor statistics, and then tested and retested it. There are some occupations which are specific for the Philippines, which would be probably named different way if the scale was used in some other society. And we include also the non-occupational position to check about the ties across the religion divide in the community. The communities that we measured were mainly Catholic Christians. We wanted to know about the people that they also know someone who is not the same religion. So we had 18 positions, and by using divisive clustering, after interviewing everyone in the community, these two clusters were found. So analytically, this method is quite similar to the previous one. So the occupations that are accessed by the same people are more likely to be in the same cluster. The cluster A is composed, again, mainly of occupations that are accessible within the slum. So it's mainly low prestige occupations, with the exception of high school teacher, barangay captain, and local government official. Barangay is maybe like Kabele in Ethiopia, like the smallest governmental unit. And these three occupations are geographically based in the slum area, or the people come to work in the slum area. So these are easy to access to anyone whose life is confined, even for anyone who is confined just to the slum area. While these occupations are more rare and are not generally found in slum areas, and these are higher prestige occupations. And especially the items in this cluster were strongly intercorrelated, and in terms of the reliability of the scale, they had very high internal consistency. So how many people you know within this cluster can be used as a good measurement scale of what is your access to the external society. So this is actually here I used the axes in a different way than the previous diagram, so I'm sorry for the confusion. But again, the female and male have similar access to the social resources, both to the internal and external. And the external are more important as a scale, because these are not so, they don't form such a good scale. Anyway, and so here, to show the relevance, or to examine the relevance of access to resources for the slum dwellers' well-being, or in some cases survival, is we looked at the relationship of the measurement on this scale and the access to potable water. So first, just explain something about how the water supply was organized in the community. So within the 12 communities that we surveyed, the system was quite analogical. There is one so-called water supply leader, a person who manages to obtain an official water supply connection from the water authority, from the water provider. And this person, first in the in-depth study community, connected a number of households and sold the water directly to them through little like garden hoses, handmade pipes, like little internal network made in the community. Some people share the connection to save the cost of the plastic house and the construction. Then some people joined later, and some people never got a connection, and they buy water from their neighbors or from others in buckets. So the people on top, they are the best off, and the people here, they are the worst off, because they have to spend the most effort to get their water, and also money, because everyone charges a little bit more to the person down the line for the same amount of water. And if you look at it using the developed scale, the water leader is the person who has the best access to the external society, as well as the most contacts within the slum. The size of the water is related to the size of the people in each, number of people in each category. And on the other hand, those without the connection are the people with the lowest number of contacts. Why is it like this? So the qualitative interviews across the systems shows that the person who becomes this water supply leader who can get the official connection is the person who has the best access to information, and is the person who has the best credentials so that they can get the connection, and also has the best connection to the local officials and informal credit so that they can implement all these. I did some interviews in some slum in Addis Ababa yesterday, and our so-called water tap attendance and something like this is also here available, and I guess that maybe you would find similar relationship here. I asked the people, how did you find a water attendance? Like, well, because my brother works for the local government and so on and so on. So maybe this could be similar. On the other hand, why some people didn't get any connection at all? So they say that they couldn't afford the connection fee. So which means basically they failed to borrow money for this lump sum investment from their friends, or they didn't have anyone to share their connection with to split the fee, or they didn't get an exception from the leader to pay later. Or some people say, oh, I didn't know about the opportunity. They just had lower access to information. And all these within this informal setting, where most of the information or money goes through informal personal channels, is related to the social networks. Something similar was found in a case of electricity supply in this community. I believe that maybe in Addis, electricity is widely supplied to everyone already a long time ago, but in Philippines, in the slums, it doesn't work like that. And just to skip, so there were four people who managed to obtain official connection, direct connection from the electricity company, from the formal utility, and they supply electricity, sell them with profit to the others who have lower, worse social connections. So that's basically it. And the last point is, I was thinking, what next, what kind of research? And I thought that since the place where there is even much faster urbanization, people coming from rural areas to urban areas, much higher speed, and where maybe because of geographical and other conditions, there's higher scarcity of resources such as water, the relevance of the social networks might be even more important and might be more useful to study. So I was thinking, maybe place like this other one. But as I told you, it's my first time in the region, and I don't really know anything. So that's why I came here to see whether this kind of research has a meaning here. And that's one of the questions which I would like to ask you.